So moving in here to our next session, this will be a discussion on litter and nuisance. This is a topic that I think this board has near and dear to its heart. It's come up several times during our discussions at regular meetings. Wanted to give the board kind of an update as to where we are now. Chris is going to take this one, steps that we've done, and some potential options, both somewhat free to minimal cost to the other options, which would revolve the cost if the board so chooses they wish to report. But anyways, I'll turn it over to her.
Okay, yep, the last push. I think both the next ones are mine. I'll try to roll through them. What's up? Yeah. This is, like Mark said, this is at the request of the board. That they asked that a group of staff come together to come up with some recommendations on litter in the city of New Bern. I thought the first thing that would be good to cover, and this was what staff kind of identified and went through the list on, just wanted to make sure that that y'all were aware of everything we are doing. So we have a full-time litter crew that is one staff member and three inmates as part of our inmate program. And I'll later in the presentation, I'll give you some statistics on the great work that they're doing. Our Parks and Rec staff, police, parks, and MLK Boulevard and the median of MLK Boulevard, if you weren't aware, we do pick up trash there. We've asked Mr. Ruggieri to address some additional enforcement of multifamily areas to make sure that we're going around checking those for litter issues in those multifamily areas like apartment complexes and that type of thing. The police department has issued 7 littering tickets since the board request, and they're also going undercover to identify offenders. Most offenders will not drop something out their window or on the sidewalk while there's a police officer standing there, so they have done some undercover operations. And we are also regularly running 3 slides and 2 videos on City Free TV. You might have seen one of the videos that we did with our public works department and a couple other staff members about the litter crew and the cans initiative and the trash cans that we've put out and all that type of stuff. And then I'll show you the slides next. And then as a side note, requested by the mayor and probably of interest to the board, we have issued 16 citations in the last year for loud trucks and vehicles in downtown. I know that was an issue as well. Yes, sir.
Chief.
Yes, sir.
Walmart. Loud trucks, speeding, burning out, all that all goes on in the Walmart parking lot.
Okay.
And a lot of trash. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so these are the 3 city TV slides that we have developed that run regularly. They're obviously aimed at education and asking people not to litter, just so you know that those run along with those 2 videos. Our litter crew, we estimate that they collected over 3,000 bags for the year of 2016. Estimated trash collection was 38.9 tons. Again, that is our one staff member and 3 inmates. You can see the decline in October, November, and December. In October, we had Hurricane Matthew, and the prison did not release inmates after the storm for the whole following week, and so we were unable to do as much litter collection in October. In November, all the inmates were removed November 17th, and we did not get them back till December 5th. There were some issues with providing the city inmates on the prison side. That was not our fault. And then in December, again, there were not enough inmates to operate the litter crew. And so that's why the decline. But you can see we're picking up, on average, about 300 bags of trash a month. And again, we collected over 3,000 for the year.
That's a lot.
Yes, it is. Because I had the statistics and I'm a math person, I thought it was interesting to actually run the numbers and see kind of where our heavy trash areas were. This does not take into account the length of the street, which I'll talk about in a minute. This is just pure numbers. You can see our large collection, probably not surprisingly, is Highway 70, Highway 43, and Highway 17, and Neuse Boulevard. But there are plenty of locations that we collect a lot of trash, and I guess you could see that as good news or bad news. The bad news is that trash is being generated. The good news is we are actually out there picking it up to make our city look better.
December looked kind of light.
What's that?
December on your sheet, it looked kind of light. So what did they say, that trash for Santa Claus?
No, sir. I said that They didn't provide us inmates that month. We didn't have enough to operate the litter crew. They provided us some inmates, but I think our priority was to get them with the Parks and Rec folks to do their work. And then if you continue to look at the statistics, a graph would not have made sense when you got one with 300, that's Highway 70, and then you got ones with low numbers, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference. So I listed the streets with where we picked up 18 to 50 bags throughout the year, streets with 10 to 18 bags, and then we also had 165 streets with 10 or fewer bags. The takeaway from that is we are out picking up trash on over 225 streets in the city. I mentioned the length of the street. David Cox, who manages this program, works for Matt, told me that actually the two busiest trash generating streets are Bay Street and East Street. Echo. These two roads are only about a block long, but probably have the highest concentration of litter per block. East Street has improved. Bay Street continues to be high concentration, but we do go in there regularly. So that just kind of shows you where our trash generation is.
Sorry, so which were those two again?
Bay Street is on there. It's in the left box, I believe.
Okay, I see it.
East Street is actually not on the list, but if you just look at generation per block, it's very high. Okay, so
East Street's down in the Dutchfield area.
Yeah, right.
East Street. It backs up to the railroad tracks just opposite of the
Fiddle Street Park.
Yeah.
Okay, and then as far as the request for us to think about other things that we could be doing, we came up with some ideas. These have kind of low or no cost ideas. We have numbers of boxes from a couple years ago of small plastic litter collection bags. I think the intent was for them to be handed out for vehicles to put their trash in the bag while they're in the vehicle and not throw it out the window. Police department has offered to hand those out at checkpoints as they're able, and as we have interactions with citizens, we can certainly get those out as much as we can. One thing we could do is to expand and publicize more the city's Adopt a Street program. We have an Adopt a Street program. We recently redid the city policy on the Adopt a Street program. That is on the website, the city website, and we thought we could work with the Appearance Commission to potentially get some streets adopted, approach the Nonprofit Council to have some of our nonprofits potentially adopt streets. City departments could sponsor streets. We would need to be a little careful about that because the public might not understand if our employees are out, our firemen are out picking up trash or something like that. They may see it as a detriment to their job of what they're supposed to be doing, but we can think about that. And then we were talking to Mr. Ruggieri, we could potentially update our land use ordinance to require more cans outside of commercial businesses. That's obviously easier to do for new construction or newly occupied businesses, a little harder to do for grandfathering those businesses, but that is certainly something that the board could consider. So those are some ideas we had, low or no cost. And then we also batted around some ideas that would come with a cost. We checked into the cost of billboards. We could do a litter campaign via billboard. Those run, they're pretty steep. They're about $1,300 to $1,900 a month. We have a Twitter.
That's a real big loss.
We have a Twitter account. We could boost Twitter posts, which allows, or forces, I guess, more people to see them. That's about $1 per follower per instance. We could boost Facebook posts. That is $25 to $100. Actually, I believe that's more per week. So you could boost a post for a week. Colleen, can you explain how that works?
You can actually put your boost on Facebook to last whatever dates you want it to, or whatever duration you want to. Obviously, those posts will not be as boosted if your dollar amount is very low. I would recommend probably not starting any less than $25 over a 2 to 4 week period, and I'd go up from there. But you can do, as she's pointed out, the same thing on Twitter. What these boosts kind of do is they reach people who are friends of folks who already like your page. The friends are already going to see it because they follow you. They target friends of those people. So you're, in effect, enlarging your circle of folks who are going to see your message if you put out an anti-litter message.
So that's what those do. Thank you. We were thinking, Mayor, I know you had started telling the citizens, hey, Friday, we're going to be out at such and such picking up litter. We could create a banner that we would hang at that location on that day, you know, come pick up litter with us or whatever we wanted it to say. Those run about $100 a piece. We batted around the idea of a movie theater ad. I think those run about $200 a week. And then, of course, we could continue to expand trash cans around generator areas. We have this data now. We could go look closer at what's generating some of that trash. Just as a reminder to the board, one of those decorative trash cans is about $700. The set of the trash and the recycling is $1,550. We don't have to put those decorative cans everywhere. We can do other options. But again, we could just continue to put more trash cans with the hope that if they're trash cans, people will put the trash in the trash can and not on the ground. So that's what the group came up with. We're happy to entertain or take action on some of these if the board would like, or we can just continue to educate our citizens and enforce the law.
Question.
Yes, sir.
It's seven littering citations. How much did it cost him?
I couldn't tell you, sir.
Did it cost anybody anything?
I'm assuming they probably paid the ticket before going to court, but I didn't get it. What's it?
And how much is the ticket?
$250, I believe, off the top of my head.
Where does it go?
I don't know. Probably
somewhere. Don't care where it goes. But we've got free signage, and I like the signs. I don't know where they came from. The yellow signs flashing says $450. Yep. I think if we put one of those signs out in the vicinity of where one of those seven tickets was issued, and say the last person cost them this much, keep dropping the daggum paper. We're going to get you. You know, we could put 150 people out there to pick up trash that one or two people are, you know, just don't care and drop the stuff anywhere. The other thing that I think we've talked about this before is maybe enlist the help of the vendors that provide some of that styrofoam or those cups or whatever, and have something printed on there that says, you know, don't litter, you know, don't be a slob or whatever. I don't care. The point is, get the message across and make somebody pay besides the taxpayers for those that don't want to have a pretty city. And while we're on it, Howell Road, that I think Commissioner Tyson and the mayor and some others got out there and picked up, that is the first spot that somebody coming in from the general aviation facility at the airport. That's their welcome to New Bern, and it's horrible again in only a matter of probably a couple of months. So my point is, you can pick it up and you can pick it up and you can bag it and you can get all the inmates you want, but what we need to do is hit them where it hurts. And I know it's difficult to identify them, but if we get seven and they got those signs that don't cost us anything, all those signs out there, the last litter were paid, this amount in this location.
Are you talking about like the digital sign that you can
where do you get those signs?
The
DOT or whoever has them? I don't
DOT
know.
DOT have them in?
Put them out there.
I think
the board
from
DOT.
Yeah, I think the board from DOT. And the fine is $100.
Put it on there. Last litterer cost him $100 right here. Go ahead and drop it again. We'll get you. That's what we need to do.
One thing I'd like to add to this, and it's kind of a digression from what you're talking about here, but we're talking about quality of life and health of our city. A lot of cities are getting electric meters for electric cars, and I think just symbolically, if we could consider, number one, the city itself having a green car to do a cost benefits analysis. I know the development services always, inspections department seem like they've always gotten the Crown Vicks or whatever's left over for the inspections department, but you know, a couple of vehicles that are visibly exposed to the city, around the city a lot, doing city services that were properly wrapped with some greenage, you know, and making the public aware that the city, be it litter, be it pollution control, such as trying to encourage folks to go green, electric meters somewhere strategically located in the city would be on my retreat wish list of, again, it would be a simple cost benefit of some of those vehicles that development services always get stuck with. all the other departments get new vehicles, they always get whatever's left over. I'm not so sure that the cost of the vehicle could possibly be cheaper than the maintenance and gas on these big cars that keep breaking them down.
We had applied for a grant recently for some electric meters since I've been here, but we never heard of it.
But good rap on a couple of cars, a couple of green cars, not going to identify which ones they'd be. Hopefully it'd be electric, put electric meter in. Those are the things that the citizens are looking for the city to do to encourage a healthier community.
I think some of this is a, I'm going to call it a cultural issue. Populations go through waves. It's okay not to litter, and then everybody sort of starts to slack down, and then you have to raise it back up in the public consciousness. So I like the idea of magnetic sign. Doesn't have to be a rap. It can be a big sign that goes on the door as things are driving around Newburgh. Thank you for littering. Your ticket gave $200 to the education program with it. But also, if we focus on the environmental impact, I think sometimes people who don't think twice about throwing something out the door or out the window would be most upset if they turned it around and said, look what I just did to the environment. And we've got a group of young people who are very environmentally conscious. They're just not thinking about littering in that way. The other one, and I don't, this is a little bit harder. When the courts award public service, you've got 50 hours public service. Could we use those on work? Saturday morning, 8 to 12, everybody with public service will be at blank. More people who are out there picking up trash is a bunch of people who will get much more picky about people throwing trash. Now, that may be too hard, and obviously that's a court issue as well. I don't know. Chief, what do you think?
I like that idea.
I apologize. I'm just talking
about people who get public service, community service from the courts. Okay, you got 50 hours community service. With it, well, then the question comes, well, what are they out there doing? Well, how about on Saturday morning they're picking up trash? And, 20 people decide that all their friends ought to put trash in the trash cans because they don't want to go pick it up anymore. I mean, that might...
I think that's a great idea.
We'll look into that.
If it comes down to it, I'll volunteer to go talk to the courts with the chief.
I don't know what it takes to be qualified to administer that
right.
community service and do the paperwork.
It may be too hard, but
the fire museum, where we were doing all the work down there 10 or 12 years ago, Sheriff Manette worked real closely with the fire museum to get inmates and people doing community service to go down there and do a lot of work.
I have them out at the convenience center, working out there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Sheriff's the one that can help you on that one.
And I do know the juvenile system has a diversion program where they help all the young kids who've been adjudicated, work in soup kitchen, mm-hmm. do things like that. The only thing that they need is someone to be an adult supervisor.
Right, and well, I was also thinking young people, not just juveniles. That something needs to be, they need something to do, we need it done.
Okay, what else y'all got? Anybody else on the litter?
The last topic is probably a little out of place. Probably should have talked about it with the Oaks Road and the stormwater discussion because it's indirectly related. But this topic started, I just intended as an education for the board. We don't have all the solutions, but this topic started when there was a realization that we were looking towards next year's budget, and Matt and I realized that we needed to put in some money in next year's budget to replace some generators and HVAC units. We haven't done that in the past couple years, but really, kind of like vehicles, we should be replacing a certain number of these types of assets every year. But I didn't just want to come in and talk about HVAC units, so we decided we'd kind of expand that to capital assets in general. I took a look at the idea of managing capital items and how we might approach this differently in the future, because I believe that the true cost of running an organization should include set-asides for future capital needs. If you know something's going to cost you $100,000 10 years from now, you probably should consider putting away $10,000 a year for the next 10 years so you can pay for it, you know, pay for what you need. These couple of examples that I'm using are some building numbers and some vehicle replacements. We've already talked a little bit about vehicles. They're really just for education. All categories of capital items include buildings, equipment, furniture, fixtures, transformers, distribution system, infrastructure, and vehicles. Those are all itemized in our annual financial report as capital items. Under buildings, just again to give you some examples, we got roofs that have to be replaced, we have HVAC units, and we have generators. So what we did is I looked at first at the 41 buildings that are managed kind of out of the general fund. That's a bigger number than I anticipated. We have a lot of buildings in the city that we manage. If you look at the average lifespan, I looked at roofs, generators, HVAC units, and our two chillers. So you can see the average lifespan. I worked with the public buildings lead, Norm, to talk about, we went through building by building and what we thought that roof would cost, and then the generators and HVAC units and the chillers. And so if your roofs of those 41 buildings are going to cost you roughly $950,000 to replace, in theory, you should be setting aside, divide that by 30-year lifespan, you should be setting aside $32,000 a year for those roofs, and then replacing a certain number every year with that money. Same with generators. They have roughly a 20-year lifespan. That's $17,000 a year. HVAC units and chillers have a 15-year lifespan, and you can see total, that's about $45,000 a year. That would get us out of this cycle that you get in where you take out debt to buy these things as opposed to putting away the money and then paying cash for them. I think we would all argue in our personal finances, it's probably better to save than pay cash than to finance and get yourself in debt. And so that's just one philosophy of how you run an organization. The last line there, you can see the amount spent per year specifically dedicated to capital on these items. And that's the average spent per year for 5 years. So we have replaced no roofs in 5 years. We have bought no new generators in 5 years. We have done a lot of HVAC work just out of Public Works operating budget. We've replaced 10 or 12 AC units in the past 12 months because they just had to be replaced, so we took it out of the Public Works operating budget. And then Matt has two qualified HVAC technicians that do a lot of our HVAC repair work, but that's just been out of emergency need and not really thought through and budgeted. It's just, oh my gosh, we got to replace this AC unit. We'll go do it out of your budget, Matt. And that's kind of how it's been handled. Now, the one thing when I created this slide when Matt was on vacation, and Matt came back, we talked through it, and he pointed out, this is just for the general fund, but all of the utility funds pay into the general fund for things like building maintenance. So the money that is allocated from the electric utility into the general fund, it was agreed upon that that would be for building maintenance. So really, you shouldn't look at the 41 buildings. We should look at all of our buildings, because that should be paid for out of the general fund, because those utilities pay into the general fund. So if you expanded that, we have a total of 215 HVAC units, a total of 47 generators, and then the buildings is probably double that number if you start looking at the roof totals. And so I thought that was an interesting slide to see, kind of like I'm sure a lot of municipalities do or a lot of businesses do, we've tended to attack these things through emergency needs the roof is leaking, what are we going to do about it? We got to go fix it. Oh, we have to go replace it. We work it into the budget next year somehow, but we don't do it systematically. And so, like I said, one theory could say you should do that a little more systematically.
Come back one.
Sure.
And you may be getting ready to hit on this, but just looking at that, you take your 41 buildings, the one item, your chillers, the amount spent per year for the last 5 years, $51,600. Obviously, y'all know we had to do two chillers. We had to do one at fire. We had to do one at police. Look how close that number is for the total if you were to set aside per year versus what the amount spent during that just a five-year period is. So that'll kind of put a little bit of that in perspective of if you just budget for it and continue that upfront so that you set aside that replacement schedule over time, it really is pretty close. And it may cost, you know, more, I guess, per se, to some extent, for those emergency type situations. But if you account for it, at least you get yourself into what the true cost is to operate whatever it is you're operating.
Yeah.
And that way, you're managing and the building repair and maintenance and the capital asset and accounting for it in the future versus just emergency replacement stuff.
Because that's when you. Taking out debt.
Yeah, or taking out the debt. So this is a way in which you manage it by thinking forward rather than waiting for stuff to happen and then being reactive.
And if I understood what you said correctly, I'm not sure that I did. If the other enterprise funds are putting money into the general fund or maintenance, is that are those monies being put in there for maintenance being used for maintenance?
Probably not, because you could. That's the amount spent regardless of source in the general fund, and really you could double the numbers we should be setting aside if you include all those other buildings right. that the utility's using, like Kale Road and all these other places, because they're paying into the general fund right. for that maintenance, and it's not that it's not being spent on maintenance. Matt's team does a lot right. of maintenance
Plan.
In the buildings. It's not being spent on the capital needs of
right.
those buildings.
Okay.
Roofs, generators, and HVACs. But we do a lot of maintenance.
Right, that was my incorrect term, and I apologize. But it sounds like if it's not fenced, so here is a pot of money that has to be used for capital improvements, that it sort of dissipates and doesn't get used as it was designed
right.
to be.
And this is not easy. I mean, that's $200,000 a year we would have to go find to set aside. But really, like I said, Mark and I have been trying to get at what is the true cost of running the city.
Mm-hmm.
You have to account for these costs, and you can't account for them by emergency only. The
right.
true cost of running the city includes these replacements and the maintenance of these things. And so, again, this is as much education. I don't have all the answers
mm-hmm.
at this point, but it's a little easier to understand with vehicles. We kind of get that. Hey, a vehicle has an average lifespan. We need to replace a certain number of year per year. And I think you think we do a decent job. But if you look at the 2016 value of the vehicles we manage in the general fund, that's $8.6 million. That's what they're worth, so to speak, or what we paid for them.
Okay.
That's the book value of those vehicles. If you just estimate an average lifespan of 8 years, some are 3, some are 5, some are 10, some are 15, I just picked 8. The required spending per year to replace all those vehicles would be $1 million. The amount we've spent each year on average for the last 5 years is $644,000. But even worse, the amount spent per year for the last 10 years has been about $400,000. So that goes to what I was saying earlier. We have a lot of old vehicles because we're not spending the money to replace them probably as quickly as we should. Now, again, 8, it could be 9, but if you did the math with 9, we're still not spending quite that much money every year. So the true cost of running the city, in my mind, would include that $1 million a year that we should be spending on vehicles or setting aside for future vehicles for the ones that last 20 years. What we do now is we take out debt and we
pay interest.
So what are the takeaways? In my mind, the takeaways are that the city has historically funded these types of things through debt service, fund balance, or through emergency. Just go find it in your operating budget and go figure it out and go fix it. An interesting note, in 2016, we paid over $300,000 in interest alone throughout our funds, which would have funded 8 vehicles. So the interest we're paying because we're in a debt, a pay through financing mode, could have bought us 8 vehicles. And I just found that interesting. Like I said, in a perfect world, we would start putting this money into a capital reserve for future purchases. I think it's questionable whether we can do that with current revenue amounts. And then we would need to do a similar analysis for other funds, other types of capital. But again, this is just beginning to try to answer the city manager's question of me of how do we get it, how much it runs to run, how much it costs to run the city. So then we can look at, are we doing it efficiently? Where can we, you know, what is the actual flexible amounts we have? We could look at consolidating, we could look at getting rid of our number of buildings, how do we do that? But you can't really start doing that analysis until you understand the numbers. So again, this started with just, oh my gosh, we haven't put any money into HVAC units or generators, and that's gonna show up in the budget this year, because we gotta replace some. And then we started saying, well, we should be replacing some every year, and how do we do that? And so it kind of turned into this, just this information for the board. Again, I don't have the answer. That amount of money to budget every year to set aside for future purchases, I don't think, given our current budget, we can come up with it, but we can certainly try. And again, just wanted to let the board know. I can ask any answering questions you have. Or Mark, did you?
Yeah, I guess for me, you know, I just look at it as, you know, at some point or another, you start looking at what, like my question to her, what does it cost for us to actually run the city? And you run the city from a perspective of, well, you have staff, that's personnel, salaries, benefits, whatever. I mean, that's pretty you can get your hands around that. You can get your hands around what our current debt service is, but then, you know, we were able to be in such a fortunate position, which it appears as if we're trending towards, that we're getting more as a pay-as-you-go, that you don't have as much debt, then, you know, you can kind of get your hands around that. But the operational portions, when you have these spikes of stuff just pops up, how awesome would it have been? Think about the last two times I've had to bring you chiller units that have gone down. And while it's easy for y'all to say, okay, well, we've got to have air conditioning for our fire guys, they're there 24 hours a day, but that was a $110,000 decision you had to make. And it came straight out of the general fund. So when you look at it, if you're managing it correctly and the future needs of maintenance and continued operation of the facilities that you have, that money set aside, it would have been very nice for me to come say, hey, we've got this problem board. It didn't get approved in the budget, but I want to get it approved for this expenditure. We're going to take it out of our capital maintenance reserve fund. And then you guys would have had an easy decision at that point to say, yes, sir, go ahead. And that's what it would have been. Or maybe some discretion is given to the city manager at that point to utilize those funds on repair and maintenance issues up to a certain amount. But essentially, the holistic question becomes, what does it cost to operate truly from day to day the city? And that would include the maintenance activities. And you know what, and sort of what made me start thinking of this was, you know, and I will say that maybe it was a deserved beating, but a little bit of the beating that we took from the board staff wise of, you know, the condition of some of the facilities that we had around. I think, Dallas, I remember just the words that you said was, you know, this is deplorable that our park system or that, not to pick on you, Thurman, but I know we're restricted on money, but like Union Point Park, whenever the soffits were peeling of paint or they might have been a little bit rotted, and then, you know, there was some marking on the mirrors or something that at that particular location, and that's one of the main parks in our location. Well, if we want to manage and we want to operate those facilities that we have, we should be managing for replacements of those. on a regular basis so that they don't get in deplorable conditions like that. Because I can tell you what happens. Mark Stevens is a staff member, takes away from board retreat meetings like this that we want to do this, we want to do this, we've got election this year, it's $275,000. Well, I feel that, Mayor, and your point's taken well, that we've generated this much money, and I think through savings this year we may do this, but there's been some house starts and stuff like that that's happened this year. But I've got $275,000 that I might have wanted to apply towards maintenance of some of these facilities, and now I've got a tough decision to make as a city manager. Okay, board's directed me on initiatives that they want to make, but yet they've also told me that we have some facilities that are in pretty deplorable conditions, and they want to make that happen as well. I've only got so much revenue to work with, only so much growth to work with, and it becomes a very difficult decision from a staff member, from the city manager, from the assistant city manager, and the budget team to figure out, okay, now, who's in the worst deplorable position?
Right.
Is it the fire department? Is it the police department? It's $110,000 for that chiller. Man, that's a lot. Think about what we could get done at these parks over here. I mean, so that's some very difficult decisions. But if you're managing that up front, and you know what those repair and maintenance costs are, and you can start pulling from that fund to continue the maintenance as you go along. So just, like I said, it's more of an information thing.
You're not going to get there in 1 year.
You're not going to get there in 1 year, but it may be something for y'all to think about from policy of how we want to start looking at things in the future. So,
could we expect some proposals relative to that in the budget workups?
I know you'll see a request for some HVAC and generator replacements. We're going to have to work that into the budget. But
do we have any surplus generators? Mayor, did we not come across,
were Mac, we weren't sure? Mac or any of those.
There was an electric services generator that was not, it was just someplace, I'm telling you where it was. I thought we came across one in our.
You might be thinking about one that we sold a year and a half ago, possibly. There was a generator that was a city generator that was for a particular entity customer we had in the city. It would not be able to be utilized anywhere else.
So we sold it?
We ended up selling it, yes, sir.
That was one, if I recall correctly, it was located at Walmart in Havelock, and they decided that they wanted to purchase their own.
Is it that or the Mayola? I obviously can't remember.
Yeah, it was one of our large commercial customers that it may be 30 years before we get another large commercial customer. So at that point, this thing's been sitting for 30 years unused. So it was better for us to go out and market it, try to get the money back on it so that we could use it versus let that thing sit there and deteriorate for 30 years. Because very few and far between do you have a large enough customer that's going to need the demand for whatever that generator was.
Going back to what Homer likes to say about, are you going to come forward with proposals? I heard that as, at some point, are you going to be able to come back to the board and say there is this delta on how much funds we need and don't have, and here are proposals A, B, and C to increase revenue to get there. Because I agree, I mean, this is, we can have a reserve fund, an emergency fund, we can have capital improvement fund so that the money is there. You know, what we're paying in interest would have funded some things. And we would, because it's, I think the city has been blessed over the last couple of years of having some surplus monies, okay? But we've also gone through.
There's only so many times you can go to the cookie jar and find the cookie.
Right, exactly. And then the cookie jar will get back to where it was in 2009 and 10, and then we're going to be back again. But the question is, how do we get to a better system of doing it?
I think, Alderman Mitchell, what you'll see this budget year is I have worked with staff. I focused on the general fund this year and went line by line through the budget with the goal of cutting a little bit of the fat that we use for emergencies and stuff like that, maybe increasing our overall contingency just so we don't cut it too much. But just trying to find some efficiencies within the budget, possibly even enough to fund all or a portion of employee raises if we want to talk about that, or what we would want to propose, some of these items that you've been discussing today. I think we can find some funds there, and I've been working hard with the department heads to identify some of those areas. So I think, A, you'll see that, and I think that's a good start. For this particular budget year, I don't think we'll be able to answer the question. I would like to come eventually, my goal would be to come to the board working with JR and department heads and say, okay, with the current buildings we have, you know, we've looked at the cars, we think we can cut this many buildings, maybe we can look at getting rid of a couple here, but really to run the city as we kind of are right now, this is what it costs, and it includes some of these things. And then we can say, well, where are we with funding all that, and what's the delta, and how can we do that? That won't happen this budget year, but I have been working hard on, I was a CFO in the last job, and it's just something that I enjoy doing, and looking at the budgets and working with JR and team to just figure out where we might be able to achieve some savings where we can go do these other things or provide raises or do whatever just by budgeting a little better. Mm-hmm. So that was my goal this year.
And obviously we've got, you know, and I hate to even open up this can of worms, but you know, we have some other big ticket items that we, you know, don't even have funded,
right.
Which is, you know, Mayor, one of your favorite things you've mentioned over the last several years, you know, you've got the post-employment benefits. That is basically an unfunded policy, or we don't have a policy, I guess, so it remains unfunded right now. And are you going to manage that? Because right now we're starting to get dinged on audits for it. Because it's a practice. Mm-hmm. And so it not necessarily deemed as in a bad accounting practice, it just has to show up now as we have to account for it. Mm-hmm. It used to not be the case. So obviously we've got to look at that. We've got some decision points to make on that. And there are costs to running the business. Mm-hmm. It's a business. And I mean, we are a government, but yet we're a business. And we've got to make sure that we're running it, that we're running it efficiently, we're running it effectively and smartly, which this would be another smart move in how you run your business.
I would call it a business model, because I think we all understand being in the black and being in the red. We have enough, we have too much, we have too little,
and the transition is hard. Obviously, the $300,000 a year, if we weren't paying interest, that money would still be available, and we could budget it somewhere else and go do other things year over year over year. Mm-hmm. But the problem is to transition from the debt to being able to put away the money for a couple of years, you have to put twice as much into it because you got to pay the $300K of debt, and then you also have to pay the $300K for the future to put that in the capital fund or whatever the numbers are. Mm-hmm. So at some point you have to continue to pay your debt while you're paying stuff forward. Mm-hmm. To get over that hump, and that's where it's really hard. And then once you get in the habit on the right side, that's sustainable, just like the $300K. Mm-hmm. Is currently sustainable, but where do we want to be putting that money is the ultimate question.
JR, in the January month-end reports, could you provide us with a debt service schedule?
Where's she going?
Sir, that is it for us as far as actual fixed presentation that we have for you. We're happy to answer any questions or take up any other items if the board wishes to do so.
I want to mention that we're fixing to have a lot of grand opening in the next couple of months down the field, and some other things going on at Lost Creek. You know, the economy is getting better, and years ago the city had to cut out an employee, present employee and retired employee picnic, which was something that was annually done. I'd like the city to think about that as to if there was the possibility of a fundraising effort to have an employee picnic sometime in the spring or summer. And it's just something to think about. I do actually have retired employees asking when we're going to have one of those again, but I think it'd be a good thing to look into. What else has the board got needs to come up? Yes, sir.
It's not a discussion. I just want a very good friend of mine and a very good friend of Alderman Odom, I'm pretty sure are friends of you all, had passed away earlier this month. He had a memorial service this morning that we were not able to be at because of conflict of our schedule. But on behalf of the mayor and the Board of Aldermen, I do want to send out our condolences and prayers to the family. Mr. Mark Bird.
Anybody else have anything?
Update on the day's end? You're not going to ask, I'm not.
Come on, ask. You can ask. Where we are with the day's end, obviously, we're with the asbestos removal. We're working on some items with regards to some other asbestos. I will let you know that there was when you do asbestos removals specifically, the state will send someone down. That person works with the contractor while they're on scene to see if there's any kind of other issues. At that particular time, they did a test and they thought that there may be a little bit more asbestos on the stucco portion. We have been working through and actually had a third party go out there and do an assessment at that same location, and they did not find that asbestos. So what we're worried about is the person that was sent down at the state level may have had some contaminated material. It could have been a transfer issue, whatever, any little thing would show up as a ding on that asbestos report. So what we're trying to work through that right now. To see if there is some other asbestos stuff that we have to mitigate. Scott's been working with one of his law partners, y'all know Clark Wright, as well as a person that they use on a regular basis for their environmental things, to have some discussions about what steps for it to take next. But as of right now, you still have the demolition crew on standby. Are they mobilizing? Where are you at with the demo?
I'm still just waiting. Yeah. I don't know what it's going to be yet.
Right. So we have that. Obviously, our marching orders, our goals are still to take it down. But we just want to get that one item cleaned up, because otherwise it will impact the asbestos removal, because they'd have to take a little bit more out. So.
Okay. Anything else?
Well, I'd like a little more detail. When is the day that somebody picks up a sledgehammer and the structure starts coming down?
That's a fantastic question. If I had the answer to you, I'd give you that detail.
I will be there.
Okay. I think the other question a lot of people get asked is what methodology of demolition will that be?
It will, explosion or? It'll be basically wreck and ball and cranes. It will not be demolition by explosion or whatever that people think or they're worried about their condition. But yeah, it'll be a you know, a block by block kind of tear down, I guess per se, with a crane or with a typical excavation materials or devices.
One real quick thing. Last Sunday there was a lot of booming going on in the city, and I got a call about it. So if you all know what it is, can we get a courtesy email or something to say if you all know? It was like going on for hours.
I don't know, and I can't confirm this specifically, but I living down in the Carolina Colors, Bern area. I would say that we hear it a lot, and I really think it is related to the bombing that the military does, or the artillery practice that they do. And I think it's either from Lejeune. I think they're fourth.
It was too close to be Lejeune, and it was too far. Well, you know, in Jones County they have an area that they practice that,
right.
But this was like coming more from the east instead of the west or whatever.
Yeah.
So I got a few calls that day, and I said I hear it, but I didn't know where it was coming from. But it could have been. It was coming that way. But anyway, that was it. Thank you.
Well, I'd like to thank everybody for coming out today. I think we got a lot done.
Yeah. Thank you for the staff. Good job. Well prepared.
This concludes the retreat.
All right.